الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة. من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد، ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان، صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected brothers and sisters, all praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may Allah's blessings be upon the final messenger Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We begin today's khutbah after praising Allah and sending salat wa salam upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by supplicating to our Lord and asking Him to send relief to Muslims around the world that are distressed. May Allah Ta'ala give peace to the Muslims in Syria and peace to the Muslims in Burma. It's always a joy and a pleasure for me to visit the Islamic Center of Irving. Today, inshallah, we will be speaking about the month of Ramadan and Quran and the preservation of Quran through the future generation of Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this ni'mah and this blessing of Islam. And every day we must wake up and say Alhamdulillahi ala ni'matil Islam. All praises are due to Allah upon this favor of Islam. This is the greatest favor Allah has bestowed upon us. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. In Hajjatul Wida, the farewell Hajj, Yawm Arafah, before Maghrib, Allah Ta'ala revealed this verse to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Suratul Ma'idah. Today we have completed your deen for you. This deen is complete, it's comprehensive, it's perfect, has no flaws. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. And we completed our favor upon you by giving this deen of Islam to you. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. Allah is the one who sent his Rasul with the guidance and the true religion, so that deen can overpower and overwhelm all the other false deens. وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. Despite the fact that the disbelievers dislike this, despite the fact that the polytheists dislike this, and Allah is a witness over this, that the Nabi came with the true deen, and this deen overwhelmed all of the false deens that man made. Allah Ta'ala blessed us with this ni'mah of Islam. Alhamdulillahi alladhi hadana lihada. This is what the people of Jannah will say when they enter paradise. All praises are due to Allah who guided us to this ni'mah. وَمَا كُنَّا لِنَهْتَدِيَ لَوْلَا أَنْ هَدَانَ اللَّهِ. We would never have been guided if Allah did not guide us. We would have been in the pits of darkness. We would have been in the pits of misguidance. But Allah Ta'ala guided us through this ni'mah of Islam. Alhamdulillahi ala ni'matil Islam. This is the greatest favor Allah can give an individual. Guidance, my dear respected brothers and sisters. Allah Ta'ala gave us an extra year of our lives, so we witnessed this glorious month of Ramadan. Success was measured by a person witnessing Ramadan. Success was never measured by a person's assets. Success was never measured by a person's earnings. It was never measured by a person's prosperity in this worldly life or the dignity and honor that he enjoyed in the social structure. That wasn't the way the Sahaba measured success. Success was measured by a person's devotion to Allah and how many more Ramadans they have witnessed. Subhanallah, Allah has given us the tawfiq to enjoy one more Ramadan. Let us enjoy this month by devoting ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through fasting in the day and turning to Allah through prayers in the night. The month of Ramadan is glorified because Allah ta'ala revealed the Quran in this glorious month. Ramadan enjoys a great relationship with the Quran, and it's befitting because Allah Ta'ala would only send down His guidance, which is full of wisdoms and secrets, to the one that has given up his desires, one who is prepared to receive this message by giving up the desires and the prohibited acts. Then he is ready to receive the wisdom from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. That is why every Nabi that received revelation from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala was in the state of fasting, and every revelation that was revealed in the month of Ramadan, whether it was the Suhuf of Ibrahim, whether it was the scrolls sent down to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, whether the Tawrat, Zabur or Injil, and of course the Quran was sent in the month of Ramadan. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس. The month of Ramadan is the one in which we revealed this Quran as a guidance to mankind. Allah Ta'ala said, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. Today we view the Quran as merely a book of worship. Today we have made Islam a very individual thing, whereas the Quran is a book of guidance. It's not merely a book of worship, it's a book of guidance in every aspect of human lives. Allah Ta'ala revealed this book upon us so we can ponder upon its meanings, ponder upon its wordings. It wasn't there for us to recite merely, although recitation is a great part of the Quran and it's meritorious and rewarding, and it was one of the functions of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yatlu alayhi him ayatihi, that he recited the Quran to us. And the recitation of the Quran, even if one does not understand its meanings, is rewarding. However, the Quran is a book of guidance, and we have to approach the Quran from that perspective and angle. What is the Quran telling me to do in this situation of my life? We have to ponder upon its meanings, and we will resolve all the problems that society is facing today. The solution for all of our problems are in the Quran. The Quran is kafi, the Quran is shafi, the Quran has everything. It's the speech of the magnificent, the creator, kalamul muluki mulukul kalam. The king is the speech of kings is the king of speeches. The Quran has everything in it. Starts with Bismillah, ends with Min al-Jinnati wa al-Nas, starts with Ba, ends with Seen, Bas, it's Kafi. It has everything in it. Turn it around, Seen and Ba, Sub, even in Urdu, Kafi. Everything is there for you. Allah Ta'ala has revealed this book. It's a book of guidance. And Allah is telling us, follow its guidance. هَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Subhanallah. This Quran is not only beautiful in its words, it's beautiful in its structure, it's beautiful in the arrangement of surahs. Allah is ending one surah, Suratul An'am, with the verse, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. We revealed this book to you that is blessed. Follow it and fear Allah, so Allah's mercy descends upon you. And he begins the next surah, Surah Alif Lam Mim Sad, Al-A'raf. اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء. Follow the guidance that Allah has revealed to you, and do not follow the deen of the false people. And the surah ends with the same hukam and the same ruling. اتباع. قل إنما أتبع ما يوحى إلي من ربي هذا بصائر من ربكم وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون. Say to them, O Prophet, that I have been instructed by Allah to follow that which is revealed to me. Following, my brothers and respect, and my brothers and sisters, following and being obedient to the guidance of Allah. Then at the end of the surah, Allah says, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. When this Quran is being recited to you, when this Quran is being recited unto you, listen to it carefully and observe silence, so you can gain the knowledge from this Quran. So you can gain the blessings from this Quran. This Quran, my dear respected brothers and sisters, is a magnet for the rahmah and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we are lacking mercy and compassion in our lives, turn to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you will find mercy. Allah says, listen to its words, stay silent when it is recited, and you will have Allah's mercy descend upon you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Today we have no peace in our lives because we're not listening to the Quran. We're not listening to it, we're not pondering over its meanings, my dear respected brothers and sisters. This Quran, Allah Ta'ala preserved its words, and Allah preserved the meaning as well. Allah Ta'ala preserved the Quran in Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's heart, and Allah Ta'ala also sent down the meanings to Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. فَإِذَا قَرَأْنَاهُ فَاتَّبِعْ قُرْآنَهُ ثُمَّ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا بَيَانَهُ. When we are reciting this Quran to you, listen carefully, O Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then it is upon us us to elaborate and clarify its meanings. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taught the meanings of the Quran, and he conveyed the meanings of the Quran to this ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted the ummah with the preservation of the Quran through different methods. Amazing book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, full of evidences and guidance, subhanallah. Bayyinatin min al-huda wal-furqan, clear-cut signs of Allah's guidance and a distinction between haqq and batil, truth and falsehood, right and wrong, good and bad. The Quran makes this distinction. The Quran makes this judgment. The Quran makes this decision. We have to approach the Quran in this manner, my dear respected brothers and sisters. Look at the mazameen and the themes of the Quran. Aqaid, beliefs, theology, ahkam, rules on how to live our lives, qasas, stories of the people of the past, and amthal, parables and similes Allah Ta'ala has mentioned. So we can ponder over those examples and reach the conclusion that we must devote ourselves to the divine, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, wahdahu la sharik, the one who is alone and unique and has no partners. And even within them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it with such evidences. Sometimes the evidences are rational and logical. Sometimes they are through naql and transmission. Sometimes they are mushahada and observation. Sometimes it is tajraba and experience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inviting us to ponder over the Quran from all of these angles and perspectives. And you will truly reach the conclusion that this is the book of the Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not written by a man. And if you are still in doubt, fa'tu bi suratim. Bring a surah like it, bring a word like it, bring even a verse like it, and you are not able to do so. That is why the Quran is known as a mu'jiza, because it makes man helpless. Man cannot help but reach the conclusion that this is the book of the divine, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala says regarding this book that we revealed it as a remembrance and we will preserve it. وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Now we see that the preservation of the Quran takes form in different ways. There are different forms of its preservation. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala prepared the Huffaz, the Hafiz al-Quran, who preserves the wordings of the Quran. Allah Ta'ala prepared the ulama and the scholars that preserve the true meanings of the Quran. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed the general believers, and from them the pious believers that preserve the actions of the Quran. So the actions of the Quran are not tainted and lost in society. My dear respected brothers and sisters, the question is, who is going to continue with this Quran conveying its message? Who is going to carry this message to the future? Who is going to spread this message from generation to generation? Which community is going to take this message forward? This, we have to remember that the knowledge we received as a ummah is from the previous nation, from the previous communities, and they received their knowledge from previous communities. Our deen has a strong tradition of isnad and transmission. Our deen is not learnt from the books. Our deen is learnt through oral transmission. Oral transmission deen is learnt from. It's not learnt from the books. And this deen, every individual has the equal opportunity to gain this guidance, to gain this Islam. So how are they going to receive this message? Who is going to continue taking this message? Are the youth of this ummah prepared for this message? What are we doing as a generation to prepare our youth? Are we establishing institutions at grassroots level? Are we developing structures that our youth can be strong and confident in their deen, empowered by their deen, and they can take this message to the future? That's the question each and every one of us has to ask ourselves. What is our responsibility? What is our duty? And what are we doing? The wealth of the nations is not in their natural resources. The wealth of the nations are not in their treasure troves. The wealth of the nations is not in their oil. The wealth of the nations is their youth. If you want to assess the future of a community, look at their youth. See which direction their youth are going in. If the youth are going in a good direction, you can predict that that community will do well. If the youth are going down a bad path, then subhanallah, may Allah protect that community. We think about the future, we talk about the future, yet we haven't seen what's coming. We are not the first batch of Muslim migrations to the United States. There were previous batches before us. Africans came to this country much earlier. Subhanallah, they were not allowed to practice their deen during that time. They were forced to work on the fields, and a lot of them changed their names and changed their deen. Then came people from the Balkan states. People from different countries, they came to this country, they didn't preserve their deen, they were more concerned with economics and their economical status. What happened? They melted away with the melting pot. Then the third batch of Muslim migration came to this country after the 50s and 60s, and you see, alhamdulillah, they did a bit more, and that's why we have masajid in front of our eyes today. But we have to learn lessons from minorities in different parts of the world where they were not able to preserve Islam correctly. If we look, for example, at countries in South America, you will find that there is no sign of Islam left in the Muslims there. No sign of Islam left. The Muslims that migrated there, they made Islam a very individual thing, and there was no social fabric or social structure. There was no concentration on the social structure of Muslims. And Islam is a collective religion. It's not an individual religion. The society is not made of one small thread. There are many different threads that strengthen that society. And we see that there was a lack of emphasis on education and Islamic education. Therefore, we saw those communities just melting away, subhanAllah. And today you can go to South America and you will see this sorry state where people say that, yes, my forefathers were Muslim, but I don't know if I'm Muslim or not. Some of them have also become murtad, apostate, and left the fold of Islam and have become Christian. Is that what we want for our future generations in this country? What are we doing to establish those institutions? That's the question we need to ask ourselves today. And my dear respected brothers and sisters, the parameters through which we measure the future should not be quantity, it should be quality. Look at the Battle of Badr when there were 313 people of great quality. Maybe yesterday you recited يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَنْفَالِ قُلِ الْأَنْفَالُ لِلَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ in Taraweeh prayers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the victory that the Muslims received in the Battle of Badr, despite being small in quantity, but they had quality, they had iman. وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا عَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا لَهُمْ دَرَجَاتٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ. My dear respected brothers and sisters, if it was about quantity, then alhamdulillah, we have 1.5 billion Muslims around the world today, but we are powerless. Subhanallah. Alhamdulillah, Muslims are building masajid left and right in America, but masajid don't defend themselves. We have to have a strong social fabric and youth that will be able to take this deen forward and protect Islam and preserve the true meanings of Islam in this country. And the reality is that until we don't produce homegrown scholars that understands the social context, the challenges that we face, the intellectual history of the West, we will never be successful as a nation, my dear respected brothers and sisters. It is really important that we think about this as a community, and we have a focus and drive to emphasize deen in our youth and to preserve deen at grassroots levels in the youth. I can give the example of another minority in America that came a few years before us, maybe. The Jewish community, similar to us in numbers, but subhanAllah, so much stronger than us when it comes to social fabric, so much stronger than us when it comes to politics, so much stronger than us when it comes to education, so much stronger than us when it comes to economics, because they emphasize a strong social structure and fabric. They looked out for each other, they established institutions, they have senators, they're on university boards. We don't find Muslims doing this today. We're more concerned about our cultural identity. You know, if one is Desi, then my child has to remain Desi. He has to be Desi still. If he's from Africa, he has to be African still. If he's from Middle East, he still has to be Middle Eastern. We're more concerned about preserving the ethnic culture, whereas the reality is that our children are American because they're born in America. They have to preserve the Islamic culture, my dear respected brothers and sisters. The fear is that we are going to lose our youth due to peer pressure. We're going to lose our youth because there is more emphasis on secular education and they are receiving 40 hours of it, and there is a lack of emphasis on Islamic education, my dear respected brothers and sisters. And children are very impressionable. We have to be very concerned about the future of our youth. We have to be very concerned about the future of our youth. We have to preserve this message of Islam, and we have to create communities that will continue taking this message from generation to generation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the ability to emphasize, to get our priorities straight. The priority is the youth. The priority is building a social structure. The priority is to build and establish institutions. That is what Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did in Medina. The institution of family, the institution of deen and taqwa, the institution of education, economics, and civic engagement and activities and duties. These are five primary concerns, areas of interest and focus Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had in his Medinan life when he was formulating facing a community, my dear spiritual brothers and sisters, as migrants to this country, we have to think along the same lines, developing a social structure and institutions in all of these departments. May Allah Ta'ala give us all the ability to understand these words and really take this collective responsibility and duty, not put this on the shoulders of a few people in the community, but really look into the importance of this as a community collectively, because we can achieve better things and bigger things. بارك الله لنا ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعنا وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم إنه تعالى جواد كريم ملك بر رؤوف رحيم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله الطاهرين الطيبين وعلى أصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك، وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات، وبارك على محمد وأزواجه وذريته. My dear respected brothers and sisters, as we concluded from the first khutbah, the importance of the youth, the importance of an educational structure, the importance of establishing institutions, the importance of a social structure and fabric, the importance of concentrating on organizations at grassroots level so they can continue conveying the message of Islam with clarity and confidence to the generations that will come, and so that we can leave this legacy behind like our predecessors leave behind. We concluded these points from the previous khutbah. Now I want to introduce something to you or put something in front of you that I want the community to think about. Alhamdulillah, when I look at this community of Irving, mashallah, I see this community as a role model community, mashallah. Allah Ta'ala has blessed you with a beautiful masjid. Allah Ta'ala has blessed you with great facilities and amenities in this masjid. And I see this masjid as probably one of the most active masjids in the United States of America, not just the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. And subhanAllah, it's envious for other communities to look upon this masjid and learn and take those models and bring it back to their masajid. A great masjid indeed. May Allah bless this community, bless your imam and leadership, and may Allah preserve you, and may Allah increase you in your deen, inshallah, and your commitment to Islam. Alhamdulillah, this community is concerned about youth. And that's why this masjid and this community established the Muslim school, the Islamic school of Irving, in 1996. You are no strangers to this school. All of you know about this school. This school, alhamdulillah, has been serving the Muslim community since 1996, and right now we're in 2012. In 2008, this school also gained accreditation from SACS. This masjid, this school, alhamdulillah, has been producing huffaz, and huffaz that are leading you in Taraweeh prayers today. This school has produced huffaz that has been representing the Irving Muslim community in competitions in Dubai, and one is going in Qatar as well. This masjid has been represented at ICNA Young Muslim Quiz. This masjid has been identified by Duke's University in talent identification. Seven of your pupils have been recognized, subhanAllah. Okay. There's so many good things going on in the Islamic School of Irving, and so many achievements have been made. Last year alone, four hafidh were produced and one girl hafidha was produced. SubhanAllah, may Allah increase the hafidha in this ummah as well. Tahfidh al-Quran amongst the sisters and scholarship amongst Muslim women. This is very important because there were many muhaddithat amongst the earlier Muslims, but today we've lost this legacy of scholarship amongst Muslim women. The Islamic School of Irving is achieving this, subhanAllah. There's so many things that I can mention about the achievements of the Islamic, you know, alhamdulillah, there's a dual credit college prep program. There's a strong emphasis on Islamiyat and Arabic language, and a strong hifz program with one of the most renowned qadis in this country, subhanAllah. Blessed with one of the best qadis in this country. The school, alhamdulillah, has about 400 pupils with 40 teachers, mashallah, that are well qualified and trained. And it's one of the appealing schools because it's not an elitist school. Now, subhanAllah, they've waived tuition for so many pupils that couldn't afford the tuition. And they're trying very hard to sustain the school with the limited funds that they are receiving. It's up to us, the community, to come together and fund this project. This is all of our responsibility. This is not just the responsibility of the parents whose children go to this school. As I was mentioning earlier, we are producing homegrown scholars, leadership that will lead this community into the future, lead this ummah into the future, lead Muslims into the future, preparing people that will be in different areas and departments, whether it's in journalism or politics, people in law, people in medicine. People that will be leading this community, inshallah, in the future. This is the opportunity we have, like the earlier people had in the other communities that I mentioned. Two communities, the Catholic and Jewish community. We have 11 Supreme Judge Courts, Supreme Court judges in this country. Seven of them are Catholic, four of them are Jewish. When are we going to see a Muslim senator? When are we going to see a Muslim in politics that is active like that? When are we going to see a Muslim in any of these areas? If we don't fund the Islamic institutions and we don't take this responsibility collectively, so I'm going to leave this khutbah, inshallah, with something for us to think about. And inshallah, after the prayer, I will request everybody to stay seated. We're going to make a small fundraiser. Because of the importance and impact of this school and the impact it will have on the lives of the future generation. We don't want to go in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment and say, oh Allah, I did nothing. If Allah questions that your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, your great-great-grandchildren were not left with a legacy, were not left with the message of Islam, there was nobody there to teach them this message. We don't want to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like that. We have to play our part. So inshallah we're going to have a small fundraising after the remaining prayer. And I'm going to request everybody, I know you need to go back work, but it's going to take a few minutes. The quicker you do this, the quicker we'll finish, inshallah. And this is up to the community, inshallah. May Allah Ta'ala give us all the ability. May Allah make it a success. And may Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala make this masjid a greater success and the school a greater success. اللهم اغفر لجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون أقيموا الصلاة